she did her PhD in Italy with Michela Maggiore, and then worked with Thibaut d'Amour in Paris and with Veneziano before coming here as a prize postdoc. And since then, she's been in Paris, attempting to see in a permanent position, which she is leaving in a few months to become a professor at the University of Maryland. So we're going to welcome her back into the fold. So she's going to talk today about gravitational waves for precessing binaries. Her title's longer than that, but I can't remember it either.
Yes. Okay, thank you for the introduction. So here is the content of my talk. I will start summarizing the main features of the dynamics in precessing compact binaries, comparing it with the case in which the binary has no spin. The bulk of my talk, at least the first part of my talk, will be the discussion and the performances of templates, phenomenological and physical, depending if they depend on the physical parameter of the binary or not, in frequency and time domain, that in fact, as we will see, have good performances in matching the gravitational wave signal, at least when the two bodies move along an adiabatic sequence of circular orbits. Then I will show also some new results that concern the transition between the adiabatic in spiral and the plunge for precessing binaries. I will discuss and comment about the estimation of binary parameters for binaries with spin and the possibility of testing GR, although this part will concern merely LISA more than ground-based detectors. And finally, I will comment and try to understand if, in fact, we need, from the point of view of theory, to work out spin couplings at higher post-Newtonian orders in order to extract with certain accuracy the parameter of the binary. Okay, so most of you here in this audience are familiar with waveforms emitted by binary in which there is no, the two bodies don't carry any spin. And in this case, the gravitational waveform as a function of time is just what is generally called a chirp. So the amplitude will increase when the two bodies go closer and closer, and also the frequency will increase. And in this simple case, so with no spin, the evolution and the waveform can be divided in typical three regions. The inspiral phase, in which if you assume that the two bodies goes around an adiabatic orbit, from the quadruple formula, the gravitational wave frequency will be just twice the orbital frequency. And then the ending point for the inspiral, generally, it depends on the mass of the two binary, of the two compact body in the binary, and is generally fixed to be the so-called last stable orbit, the innermost stable circular orbit of the binary. And then after that, you have a plunge, a merger, and a ring down if a black hole or neutron star is formed. Now, if you have a binary in which the two bodies carry a spin, the first important effect is the fact that now the motion doesn't occur on a plane. The plane will move in space, change in space, and this will precess and modulate both the amplitude and the phase of the gravitational wave. And moreover, your waveform will depend now on many, on much more parameters than in the case without spin, because you will have also the dependence on the magnitude of the spin, the direction of the spin in the sky, of the orbital angular momentum in the sky. Moreover, the gravitational wave frequency will be not only at twice the orbital frequency, but will depend also on the precession frequency, okay, on which the spin and the angular momentum will precess. And another important fact is that now the ending frequency of the inspiral part, the so-called last stable orbit, will also depend on the spin, not only on the mass of the two bodies. And in fact, one thing that I want to comment at this point, is the effect of the ending frequency on even the detectability of inspiraling spinning binaries for gravitational wave interferometers. So in fact you can easily understand what how the innermost stable circular orbit changes when you have the spin, just realizing that in fact the spin orbit couplings will make the two body gravitational interaction more repulsive when the spins are aligned with respect to the case in which they are anti-aligned. And this you can easily see just writing down the radial potential between the two bodies. So generally, if you consider only at Newtonian level, you have the attractive part, then the centrifugal part. No? And in fact, if you disregard any GR effect, the potential will just go up here. Okay? Then due to GR effects, there is a modification of the potential in this region of small radii. And generally, if you don't have the spin, the position of the ISCO is just the point in which this maximum and this minimum will merge in horizontal inflationary point, and this will define, in fact, the ISCO of the binary. This is just the radial potential for different value of the angular momentum. Now, when you add something that is repulsive, when L is in the same, is in the same direction of L, what happens is that you add something here repulsive, and so the innermost stable circular orbit is pushed inward, okay? At smaller radii it occurs. And this has an interesting effect, for example, from the point of view of the signal-to-noise ratio. So here I'm plotting the signal-to-noise ratio as a function of the total mass of the binary for an equal mass binary at 100 megaparsec. I choose this distance because the three LIGOs could see a 10 plus 10 solar mass binary at this distance with a signal-to-noise ratio around 8, the three LIGOs, okay?
So this is the initial interferometer.
Yes, this is LIGO 1, and this curve is obtained if you fix the ending frequency with the Schwarzschild value that many of you generally use. And these other three lines refer to the case in which I use as an ending frequency prediction from post-Newtonian calculations, and I found that in the no-spinning case, this is the signal-to-noise ratio. When the spins are anti-aligned, the ISCO is pushed outward, and so you reduce, in fact, the signal-to-noise ratio. But when the spins are aligned, you can increase it quite a lot. Okay? But you also are more sensitive to higher masses, and even at 100 solar mass. So this, of course, uses optimal matching. Okay? So in order to get this signal-to-noise ratio, you have to know the waveform exactly. Okay? But here, so I think that this is quite interesting to understand the first effect of the spin. Okay. Now, just to give you some idea of the typical time scales involved in a binary system with spin, in a case in which there is no spin, the binary is characterized by two time scales, the inspiral time scales that is fixed by radiation reaction effects, so the quadruple formula here, and the time scale of inspiral is just given in terms of the radial separation between the two bodies by this formula here. M is the total mass of the binary, and eta is the reduced mass divided by the total mass. It's a parameter that will enter in many of the equations afterwards. It ranges between 0, the test mass limit, and 1/4, the equal mass case. Now, the orbital time scale, you can easily derive it from the orbital period, just Newton's law, for example, and this scales like this. Now, if you consider only spin-orbit coupling, you write down the equation of precession for the spin and the angular momentum, and you can, write what are the instantaneous precession frequency of the spin and the angular momentum, and if you go through the mathematics, you find this expression in terms of R. So when the two bodies are far separated, are quite a lot separated from each other, so R is big, you can, deduce that the orbital period is much smaller than the precession time scale, that are much smaller than the spiral time scales. Okay? So this means, in fact, I'm going to use this in a moment, that so assuming that radiation reaction will circularize the orbit, you can, in fact, almost consider that L and S will be constant in one time scale, okay? But this, of course, this approximation very much when then the two bodies approach each other, okay? Okay, so in this talk, I'm going also to use results from analytical calculations, so post-Newtonian expansion calculations. I will, at some point, will do a comparison with some results from quasi-equilibrium configurations. Otherwise, I'm using post-Newtonian calculations. And in fact, this first part of my talk, I'm going to just evolve the dynamics as an adiabatic sequence of circular orbits. And my degrees of freedom are not many, in fact. I have the orbital frequency, omega dot. This formula is just the balance equation. It's just the fact that dE over dt is equal to minus the flux of gravitational waves at infinity. I rewrote it in terms of omega. And omega dot in post-Newtonian calculation is just given by this long expression where these coefficients are very complicated numerical coefficients in terms of the masses and the spin. This is known to 3.5 post-Newtonian order. This is an expansion in m omega, so in over c square, okay? And the spin effects are not very much known, in fact, are known at 1.5 post-Newtonian order, spin orbit, and spin-spin at 2pn. And then I have the precession equation for the spins, so the spin orbit part and also the length steering part, the spin-spin part. By the way, these equations were determined by various authors, and the precession equations are also valid in the strong, in the case of bodies with strong interactions like black holes. Okay, so now this equation looks very simple, not so simple, in fact. But there exist two limits, two classes of binaries in which this equation can be solved almost almost exactly. And these two classes of binaries were in fact, and the solution were obtained for the first time by the following authors. So there are two cases in which you can in fact reduce the dynamics at the dynamics of only one spin. Okay? And this is the case in which you take equal mass binary, and the only spin that you have is the total spin, but you have to disregard spin-spin couplings, or you consider small mass ratio binaries in which the mass of one of the two is much smaller than the other. And in this case, the only spin that really matters is the spin of the larger body. Okay? So in this case, the precession equation becomes like this. And in fact, you can understand what is going on geometrically very in a very simple way. So in the previous equation, if I replace L with J, the total spin, I can rewrite the precession equation in this way. And now in many of the configuration, in fact, of single spin binary, the dynamics is characterized by the fact that momentum direction is almost fixed in space, okay? But J in amplitude will decrease because of radiation reaction effects. So what you have is that L and S will just precess along J with a typical precession frequency that is just given by J over R cube. R is the distance between the two bodies. And now, in this particular case, in which the equation reduced to these two simple equations, you also find that the angle between L and S remains constant. L has to decrease because of radiation reaction effects. And this means that if you consider, for example, the dynamics at a certain time t1, in which you have l1, s1, and j1, and a later time t2, since this angle has to remain constant between L and S, and L has to decrease in time because of radiation reaction effects, the angle between L and J will increase, and the angle between J and S will decrease. So it's very simple what is going on in this case. And in fact, in this particular case, you can even work out that the precession phase has a very simple dependence on the orbital frequency. It's just a power law, okay? In two particular cases, in fact. So for this single spin binary, you have two subcases. The case in which L is much larger than S, and since the orbital angular momentum is given at Newtonian level by this expression here, this means that the orbital frequency has to be very small in order that this equation is valid, okay? So when the two bodies are very far apart, this fact is true, and alpha is just proportional to omega minus 1. While in the case in which S is much larger than L, and this occurs mainly at the last stages of in spiral, or when eta is very small, so small mass ratio, you have this other power law. Okay, so why we need, why it's important to have these two simple, the case in which you can almost work out analytically the expression of alpha, because we would like to build the templates, for example, in the frequency domain, that will contain modulational effects. So they will contain modulational effects that you would like to know almost analytically, no, in order to have simple templates. And so we are going to use in a moment this fact. I just wanted to comment on which, in fact, for which combination of the masses the precession is more important, okay? In this plot, I'm showing the number of precession cycles obtained from the precession frequency that I showed you before in two cases. In the small mass ratio binary case, in which I fix one of the two binaries to be a binary with just one solar mass, and the other binary can be between 1 and 15. And I'm choosing two different values of the angle between L and S here. And you see that the number of precession cycles are important, especially with respect to the equal mass binary case. This is the equal mass binary case and high mass binaries, okay? So here the number of precession cycles is not very high. It increases when the two bodies have a low mass, okay, and are equal, for example, between 1 and 2 solar masses. And it's also important, yes? Yes, this in fact is evaluated between 40 Hz and the ISCO. This is really the one that interests the band.
So throughout this, you're going to be talking about LIGO 1?
Yes, always.
Because that's what we're doing right now.
LIGO 1 parameters? Yeah, at some point, I hope to arrive to that point. Yes, I will discuss that. Okay, so. I told you, what I was saying, the conclusion of that plot was that small mass ratio binaries or binaries with low mass and equal and low mass are the most crucial ones, okay, that could have precessional effects that are quite important. Now, I told you at the beginning that one of the problems of designing templates for spinning binaries is that the binary depends on many parameters. And so the number of parameters, just to give you an idea, can go between 11 and 17, depending if the two binaries, the two bodies carry spin or not, okay? I'm including also the so-called directional parameters in this counting. And so for some years, people have been thinking of suggesting phenomenological templates, so templates that do not depend on the physical parameter of the binary. So you introduce some phenomenological parameter, but still have reasonably good matches with the signal, okay? And one of these proposals that now goes under the name of Apostolato Sansaz was very simple. The idea is just to add to the stationary phase approximation phase some modulational effects. So here I don't have the time to go into the details, but when you, in the case of non-spinning binaries, you can work out the signal in the frequency domain as an amplitude and a phase. The phase is what is more important if you want to use match filtering techniques, okay? And so the phase for non-spinning binaries, you can work out it in post-Newtonian calculation, and there is, f to the minus 5 over 3 in front of it, and then there is an expansion in f that actually is again an expansion at the end due to the v over c expansion in post-Newtonian calculation. And this coefficient here depends on the mass of the binary and the spin of the, on the mass of the binary. So the idea of Apostolato was to add to this non-spinning part a modulation part that depends on c and delta are two arbitrary coefficients, and this is the precession phase that I discussed before, that in two particular cases we know the power law in F, okay? So beta is the scale of precession. And so at the end with this phase, the idea was that this phase was able, with this phenomenological coefficient, C, delta, and beta, to have good performances in matching the signals, okay, from binaries. However, this template family was tested first by Apostolatos and then by the following people, And it turns out that has not very satisfactory performances. The fitting factor are quite low, okay? The overlap between the template and the signal. And moreover, and more importantly, it has a very high computational cost because you have to introduce three more intrinsic parameters, C, delta, and beta, okay, besides the two masses. There is a version of this template family that use spike waveforms that was introduced by these authors that improve a little bit the performances, but I'm not going to discuss this here. Okay, so now I want to show you why, in fact, to convince you why, in fact, this template family was not working so well. And this we could understand, in fact, this looking better at how modulational effects enter in the gravitational wave signal. Okay, and this was done, in fact, in this paper with Ian Bache and Michele Vallisneri. And this allowed us to propose a new phenomenological template family for precessing binary. Okay, so in fact, to better understand how the modulation effects enter in the signal, you have to remember that so the orbital plane now, as I said at the beginning, is not fixed. No, it changes in time, and the gravitational wave signal is proportional to the second derivative of the quadrupole moment. Now, if this is the instantaneous orbital plane and n and lambda are unit vectors along the radial direction and the tangential direction, the second derivative of the quadrupole moment can be just written in this way. Okay? Now, you can introduce a frame attached to the binary that moves with the binary because the orbital plane is precessing, and you can express n and lambda in terms of these vectors E1 and E2. Now, here we are interested in an adiabatic sequence of spherical orbits, and for that, you have this relation between n dot and lambda, where omega is precisely the angular frequency that I used before in my equations. Okay? Now, in general, phi dot is different from omega because it depends, in fact, how E1 and E2 precess in space. However, we first notice that the omega that I showed you before in the positional equation is not very much modulated, okay? Moreover, we introduce a new convention for the frame that describes the binary, the evolution of the binary, in which we impose that E1 and E2 precess in a certain way, okay? Omega is a certain expression that, okay, I didn't write it here, but in such a way that phi dot is precisely equal to omega. Why this is interesting? This is interesting because this allows to rewrite the quadrupole term here in this way, where E plus and E cross are the polarization tensors just that you can obtain in terms of E1 and E2, and they only contain the modulational effects, okay? While phi t here, because I impose this condition and omega is almost non-modulated, I can put all the modulational effect in this E plus and E cross. And this is important because now when I consider the signal after the interaction with the interferometer, I have this first part that what I discussed before, so in the page before, the wave generation part, and then I have also to take into account the detector projection, okay? So these are just the angles that describe the polarization of the wave and also the orientation of the binary with respect to the detector.
Can I just stop?
Yes.
Just for motivation. So what you're doing is you're writing this in a form that is much simpler than it had been written before.
Yes.
And you're factoring out the dynamics of the of the precession modulation times just an n spiral. As somebody, in our modern era, we're quite happy to work with complicated equations on computers and their implementation. And so one might not see at first sight why it's particularly important to do this.
Well, I want to say why.
Okay. Well, let me get to a why that you've not discussed, but let me just ask if this is the motivation. What in the data analysis, if you don't do things in a particularly simple way, then you wind up with billions of waveforms you've got to analyze, which is not feasible in data analysis. So So this is all driven, I presume, is that correct? It's all driven by trying to turn the data analysis problem into a manageable problem.
Ah, yes, yes, okay. Yes, okay. Yeah. Because in fact, you will see it in a moment why this way of writing the signal allows to understand how to build, in fact, the template and how you can reduce the high computational cost of the Apostolatos templates, you know? Okay, because once, so I put all the modulational effect in the wave generation part. This coefficient, these angles here are constant in our precession convention frame. And now if you do now the stationary phase approximation of this signal, what you find is that you will have a non-modulated part, so the carrier part, that is like the non-spinning SPA, okay? Because this part here depends on the phi that I said is non-modulated. And then there is the part that depends on E plus and E cross, where now in this part you can include the precession effects. So the precession effects come from the precession of the modulation effect in the waveform come from the precession of E plus and E cross. And so now in this part, this complex amplitude, you can write in terms of something like this. So now you can apply the Apostolatos answers here, okay? And you have this coefficient here that are complex, and then you have delta here, and this is the precession frequency. So what does it mean more practical way? So this was, in fact, the template family that we proposed. So you have the amplitude part, so the Newtonian part, like non-spinning case. Let's forget a moment of this f-cut. And then you see that you have a complex amplitude that depends on six coefficients, okay? And then the cosine of beta, the sine of beta f to the minus p. And now the important thing is that now these coefficients, you can treat them as extrinsic, so-called extrinsic parameters. So extrinsic parameters, for people not familiar with them, means that you can maximize the overlap analytically. You don't have to lay down templates along this direction, okay? Because, in fact, you can easily work out that when you evaluate the overlap, the maximization on C1, C6 is just analytical. It's just what you do generally with the initial phase, okay? You get the square root of the sum of the square of the overlaps, okay? So this coefficient here are not, don't generate, don't, are associated with a very low computational cost. This was not there with the original Apostolatos answers, okay? And moreover, and more importantly, these coefficients in the complex amplitude part of the signal allows, in fact, to mimic the precessional effects much better than what was the original Apostolatos answers. And I show you, in fact, in a plot in a moment because it takes some time to load it. Sorry. And by the way, so the phase part is just the non-spinning waveform, okay? So here are the, actually, Yi gave me these plots, and he said that this is the best that he could get from the simulation, okay? So the best examples. So here you have the phase modulation. So he generated a signal for example, this was for a 10 plus 1.4 solar mass black hole binary. And he worked out the modulation part in the phase. And as you see, this is modulated. This is a cosine of alpha p, okay? And the template the template that I described in the previous transparencies gives also a phase modulation, a modulated phase with the same behavior, okay? It's oscillating with a cosine of alpha p. In fact, in this example, you have also here some wiggles that you don't have here, but this is not, so the main effect of catching the oscillation is there, okay? The wiggles are maybe due to the fact that, in fact, when you use this power law dependence on the depreciation frequency on the on f, no, you are assuming that the precession is dictated by L and S around J, as I told you at the beginning. But actually, it's a little bit more complicated because you see in the signal is not it's E plus and E cross that contain the modulational effects, and they don't simply precess along J. It's a little bit more complicated, okay? But thanks to the six coefficient C1, C6, we can in fact also reproduce sometimes those wiggles, and we can also reproduce cases in which the modulation in the phase, for example, doesn't occur at the precession frequency, but at twice of it. So in this example, you have a cosine of alpha p, but you have two oscillations in alpha p. And the template is able also to reproduce the two oscillations, okay? In fact, in this case, the amplitude of the template is peaked at twice the orbital frequency. Okay, so all this, in fact, although the paper in which we proposed this template family was the paper with Yanbei and Michele, we relook all this more recently with Yipan, and in fact, we could understand even better what really this template bank is doing. Okay, so just to show you some performances, I don't know if the numbers here are very small. So these are the performances, so the fitting factors, in the case of high mass or small mass ratio binaries. We get these results taking 500 or sometimes 1,000 configuration of the spin distributed uniformly in the sky in the direction of L. For these high mass binaries, we found the following improvement. If we were using the stationary phase approximation without spin, we will get these numbers in green, okay? When you introduce, when you use, on the contrary, the template bank with the precession frequency, I mean the modulation effects included, you get these improvements, no? That are quite important. However, in the case of high mass binaries, there is a warning because sometimes the increase in overlap to go from here to here, it's of the same order of magnitude or sometimes lower than the increase of the threshold that you have to impose. Okay? At least this was obtained using Gaussian noise.
An increase of threshold because you do have more parameters.
Yes, yes.
Maximum.
Yeah. However, it's also true that the templates are closer to the signal, okay? And it's also true that I think the last word should be left to people really of LIGO that will do the simulation with the pipeline, etc., to really understand that. But notice that even if I don't use the modulation family, I use what is generally called the BCB1 family, that is this one, I also get a good improvement, okay, for high mass binaries. Now, for small mass ratio binaries and equal low mass binaries.
So the black line is BCB1.
Yes.
Without precession at all.
Without precession at all.
And the blue, that's BCB2, or that's,
yes,
physical? So that's not yet the physical.
No, it's not the physical. No, no, no. Okay, and here we have the case of small mass ratio binaries, and you see the improvement in overlap here is really big. I mean, in 10 plus 1.4 case, I go from 0.78 to 0.93. So here there is not a problem of the threshold. And this is the values for this other combination of masses. And for an example in which we took a low mass binary 2 plus 2, the fitting factor is also very high, 0.96. These are all maximal. Eh? This is the worst case.
So how many templates does one need then with BCB2?
I will go to that point. I will have
okay.
But I'm really running. Okay, anyway, I will go very fast on this part. This is just the projection. We also work out the region of the template space where these binary are located, okay?
It says to appear, but this is all published, in fact. It says to appear, but this is all published.
No, the figure on the left is published. The one on the right is the paper that we are finishing. Okay, so... So this is, in fact, a projection on the space beta epsilon zero of all the binary, because in this most recent work that we are finishing with Yipan, in fact, we looked really at the small mass ratio case that was not analyzed in the first paper that was more devoted to high mass binaries, okay? Okay, so I want to say something, in fact, about the metric, because the metric in this case can be worked out analytically. And so I don't have much time to go into the details of that, but I just want to say that originally, I mean, you have the metric in this larger space where you have the intrinsic parameters and the extrinsic ones, okay, the C1, C6, and T0. Then we projected the metric in the space of the intrinsic parameters, and we maximize, if you want, we maximize the overlap with respect to the extrinsic parameter of the template. So this corresponds to a minimization with respect to the delta sigma. So we get the projected metric, and then we, since the projected metric depends still on the extrinsic parameter, we have to get rid of the extrinsic parameter, taking, in fact, a minimization. I don't know if, okay, maybe I have to be a little bit more. So generally, if you, so the metric describes the degradation of the overlap between a template in a position lambda and a template in a position lambda plus delta lambda, no? So you can consider that this is your signal and this is your template, and so you maximize on the parameter, the extrinsic parameter of your template, but you want to be in the conservative situation in which you minimize with respect to the parameters of your target. So this defines what is generally called the min-max. Okay, only for people that are familiar with that. But anyway, so we got the projected metric with this procedure that is analytical. And well, no, it's not, the last step is not analytical, but it depends only at the end on the parameter beta, because there is a translation invariance with respect to psi 0 and psi 3. Okay? And so in this case, we could also place templates using this translation invariance, and preliminary numbers that were worked out by Yanbei, but now they are rechecked by Tagoshi also, would say that for this range of masses, so small mass ratio binary, you need this number of templates. So this is for small mass ratio binary. So the smallest mass is 1m, that is really very small, so, and the number is of this order of magnitude. Okay.
So that's not a problem.
I don't know.
Certainly not unreasonable. It's not a big problem.
Okay. Before going to the templates in the time domain, I want also to say another thing that concludes this work on also with Yipan, because we also, so I discussed a phenomenological template family in the frequency domain, but actually we could also derive a more physical one, because we realized that the parameter, what I was calling here alpha precession, no, the precession phase, actually can be worked out analytically in terms of m, eta, kappa, and chi. Okay? In fact, this result was already in the paper by Apostolatos et al., but okay, we rederive it also independently. And so this means that your chi and kappa are just, kappa is the angle, in this case, this is true for a single spin binary, okay? And kappa is the angle between L and S, and chi is the magnitude of the spin, okay? So in this case, we can even have in the frequency domain a template family that in the phase you put the stationary phase approximation with all physical parameters, and the modulational effect you express them in terms of physical parameters. The only thing that are non-physical are still the coefficient C1, C6. And this template family has the advantage of being physical, so but has the disadvantage that the metric will be more complicated, and it will be depending on four intrinsic parameters and not three.
So,
okay.
So by physical, what you mean is that you're not making any kludges here. You're not not trying to fit with in some fitting function that...
Actually, I really mean that this is expressed in terms of the parameter of the binary. the true binary. In fact, we also evaluated the systematic errors that you can obtain in this case, and the shear mass it's 1%, the total mass and eta 10%, and these are the other parameters, okay? Because, of course, because there are the parameters C1 and C6.
Those are accuracies with what signal to noise ratio?
No, this is just, no, are the biased, this okay, so you produce, you have your signal, your target signal, with certain parameter m, eta, kappa, and chi, and you try to evaluate the, you evaluate the overlap, the maximized overlap, with this template family, and you get the maximum at certain value of m, and this is the biased.
Okay.
Okay, and okay, I don't have time to say this. So now I want to discuss. So the motivation of the, of this template family that I discussed to now was also so. This template family is very simple. It's in the frequency domain. The metric is analytical. However, and the performances are quite good, but are not excellent in the sense that the fitting factors are not one. Okay. Now, there is the possibility of having a template family for adiabatic binaries, for binaries moving along adiabatic circular orbits that has fitting factor equal to one. And this is just, in fact, the model for the signal that you use as a template, okay? So this was the gravitational wave signal that I wrote before. And now the idea, why don't we implement this? This is in the time domain, okay? So it's more complicated than in the frequency domain, maybe. But this will have a fitting factor one with a neutron star, with a neutron star black hole, with a single spin binary, okay? And how do you implement this? Well, one of the problems is to, okay, let me go back a moment. So this template family has four intrinsic parameters, okay? Because here we are dealing only with a binary with one spin. And then you have some extrinsic parameters on which you can maximize analytically, almost analytically. In fact, in this work with Yanbei, Michele, and Yi, we work out an analytic maximization over the initial phase, the parameter alpha here, and we do a numerical maximization over theta and phi. Okay. However, this numerical maximization can be a bit time consuming, and so we even propose a two-stage detection scheme that at the first stage use a algebraic maximization on these two parameters, but on a statistics that is not actually the unconstrained, okay, the constrained ones. So the problem is the following. This QIJ and PIJ are three-dimensional symmetric trace-free tensors, okay? So they depend on five independent parameters. However, the PI are not completely independent because they are constrained by the fact that they are expressed in terms of these angles, okay? So if you assume that they are unconstrained, you can actually analytically maximize on them, okay? But this won't give you, this is not the exact statistics. The exact statistic will be constrained, okay? But we thought that, we proposed a two-stage scheme in which for each time of arrival, you can actually use the unconstrained statistics. And then only for the signal that are higher than a certain threshold, then you can apply the maximization on the constraint statistics, okay? This is just to save some time. Anyway, so with this template family, we can, we also work out the metric. Actually, we also obtain that the four-dimensional space, 1, 2, 3, 4, is actually three-dimensional. You have some reduction curves there, and the number of templates that you need for this range of masses, that is almost what I was showing you before, is of this order of magnitude, okay? So it's a little bit smaller than for the frequency domain templates, okay? Because of course in that case you have more signals, okay? You are adding more shapes. So this is the result for the time domain. But in this case, you really will get a fitting factor of one that is very good.
This is only for a extreme mass ratio.
Yeah, but we also extended it to double spin precessing binaries. Okay, because okay. So in fact, this was only for neutron star black hole. However, we thought that. Okay, so let me say it in another way. So I showed you at the beginning that there are two classes of binaries for which I can reduce the dynamics to only one spin. Okay, equal mass binaries without spin-spin and small mass ratio binaries. So what happens when you include spin-spin effects and you consider intermediate mass ratio binaries with spin-spin effects? Well, actually, the dynamics doesn't change very much because the spin-spin effects that are there when you have a double spin precessive binaries modify the evolution of the angle between S and L and J, adding oscillations, but to the monotonic evolution, okay? And so we thought, okay, why don't we use then as a model for the template still one spin? But it will be effective in the sense that it corresponds neither to the total spin of the binary nor to the spin of one of the two, but something else. And we tested this template family against the source modeling, and we found these results that are very good. The fraction of configuration as a function of the fitting factor for these masses. So you see here we are not in the small mass ratio case, but 3 plus 3, 6 plus 3, 6 plus 6, etc. And you see that except for a small percentage, the fitting factors are really very high. Okay? And in fact, the reason why this is true is these are examples obtained from the maximization of the fitting factor. In blue, you have actually in green, you have the angle between S and J and L and J, okay, for your target model, your source. And in blue, this is the template the templates obtained from the maximization of the overlap. And you see that although the template is not able to, cannot have oscillation because it's a single spin model, however, it tried to be in the middle of these oscillations. And in fact, this case here corresponds to a very high fitting factor where this behavior occurs. So in this case also, we work out the metric and the number of templates now for 315, it's again of the order of 10 to the 5. Okay, so I don't have time to say this. I want to say now something so up to now, I showed you results for templates that are able to get high overlaps. So good performance in matching signal from an adiabatic evolution of circular binaries, okay? So binaries moving along circular orbits. Now, what about going beyond the adiabatic approximation? This problem of the transition between the spiral and the plunge is particularly important for high-mass binaries, for binaries that will end their life in band, okay? Not for small mass ratio binaries or small mass ratio binaries. So this is, in fact, what I'm going to show you in a few slides. It's just work done recently. In fact, we are going to finish the paper in a few weeks, I hope, with Yambe and Thibaut Damour, that, in fact, extend the work that I did a few years ago with Thibaut, in the case without spin. So in this case, we use an Hamiltonian to evolve the system, an Hamiltonian obtained from post-Newtonian calculation, but resummed using the effective one-body approach in the conservative part of the dynamic, and using Padere summation for the flux. Okay, and now the first important part of this work was to work out the radiation reaction force, including spin couplings. That is important if you want to describe the evolution of these objects during the spiral and then the plunge. Okay, And so this radiation reaction force was the first part. And then we evaluated for example, various features of the dynamic of during the non-adiabatic evolution. But here I want to show you, in fact, three things. The first one is I'm doing here a comparison between up to now I use only one model for my source. No, it was this adiabatic model in post-Newtonian calculation. Now I want to compare that model at different post-Newtonian orders and also compare it with the model coming from, for example, the effective one body. Okay, and in this plot I'm evaluating the energy at the ISCO as a function of chi is because in this case I'm considering aligned spin. This is in fact related with the magnitude of the spin of the two bodies, and this is the frequency at the ISCO as a function of chi. And in this plot, I'm having different curves. So this continuous curve in black and this in cyan corresponds to the EOB at 3pn and 2pn, okay? And this in the points here corresponds to 2pn and 3pn using the post-Newtonian expanded dynamics. And with the square, I'm using actually results from your paper, with the paper of Pfeiffer, Tiokoski, and Cook, in which using quasi-equilibrium configuration, in fact, it's the only paper in which they, in the case of quasi-equilibrium configuration, they work out the ISCO for the case of aligned spin or anti-aligned for different value of the magnitude of the spin. And what I want to underline here is that, you see, these models are not very far from each other up to the point in which either the magnitude of the spin becomes very big. Okay, so around this chi 0.25, the different models become really to be very different. So this means that, in fact, for spin aligned and the high magnitude of the spin, I don't have a good representation of the dynamics in post-Newtonian calculation or even comparing with quasi-equilibrium. And the points from the paper of Pfeiffer ends here because also they say that when the magnitude of the spin is quite high, it is very difficult to find. In fact, the ISCO maybe doesn't exist. I remind you the first figure that I had in my talk in which I was showing you when the magnitude of the spin is high and the spin are aligned, you really are in the region of the space-time where the two bodies are very close, and so high effects, non-linear effects are important. You wanted to say something? No, I thought you, okay. Anyway, so, but this is a problem only for very massive binaries, because if you evaluate the frequency at the ISCO for so this line here represents a line evaluate that says that for a binary with 40 solar mass, this is the frequency that would correspond to 400 Hz. Okay? So this means that this deviation of the different models actually is only important for binaries of high mass. But we should not worry that can also exist, and in fact in the first figure of my talk I showed you that 100 solar mass binaries equal mass, they could be very interesting because they have high signal to noise ratio. However, this can pose a problem, okay? Okay, so here I want to tell you something about the energy released, because we evaluated how much energy is released during the last stages of in spiral and plunge, okay? So this example is for a maximal spin system, 15 plus 15 solar mass. And in this plot, I'm going to explain it in a moment, carefully. It's the energy release in divided by the total mass of the binary from 40 Hz on. This is the instantaneous frequency, okay? And before 40 Hz, the energy release is of the order of 0.1% of M. And the different lines corresponds to the case in which, for example, the continuous line here, it's a non-spinning binary, okay? This line, vertical one, is the position of the ISCO. And so from this point to this point, that is the actually the ending points of these cards here, corresponds to the point in which we really cannot believe anymore in the equations that we are using. Okay, so we stop here, in this case, or here, or here. And so, for example, from here you can evaluate how much energy is released from the ISCO up to the end, okay? And these other examples are for aligned binaries, or generic up, generic down are, in our examples, binaries with spin at 60 degrees or 120 degrees. And you see that, in fact, in the anti-aligned case, or generic down, the energy release is not very high, but it can become of the order of 5%.
So you're telling me that there can be more energy release after the ISCO, during the plunge?
For these two? No, actually, okay, so these two corresponds to the aligned case, and you don't see here the vertical line that corresponds to the ISCO.
The ISCO is
at very high frequency, okay? And, okay, so, and another interesting thing is that the rotation parameter J over E square, we found that it's always smaller than one at the end of the spiral, so a Kerr black hole could really form at that stage. So, finally, for the example of gravity wave signal from in spiral and plunge, we even add the ring down part, but this is a less robust part, I would say, of the calculation. And here we have an example of a half maximal spin binary, 15 plus 15. And again, generic up 60 degrees, the spins and at the beginning, and generic down 120 with respect to the angular momentum. And so these are three waveforms. They all end, they spiral at t equal to zero, okay? That is here. And here you have the position of the ISCO for the three examples that are given there. So now the first thing to do will be to try to see if our templates in the frequency time domain, whatever, are able to match this waveform from the last stage of the spiral and plunge. I'm very positive about that because we already know from the work VCV1 that we are able to match signals from high mass binaries. So the inclusion of spin is not going to make a big difference, okay? Now, I have still a few transparencies, and it's 5 o'clock. Can I go other? I have, I think, five transparencies until it is.
Well, in your rate of transparency a minute, that's okay.
Okay. Okay. Well, but this is the parameter estimation you were interested in.
Okay.
So, okay. So, so after SUS modeling detection for adiabatic and non-adiabatic waveforms, I want to say something about the parameter estimation because at the end, this is what maybe will be the most interesting thing to do, extract some science and astrophysics from these waveforms. And okay, so the first thing is that so I want to point out some differences between the case in which the binary contains spin, but they are non-precessing, and the case in which they are precessing. So first of all, it was realized already, actually 10 years ago now, that when you have align or anti-align spins, you have a degradation of, in the estimation of the parameter. Of the binary. And this occurs because you have strong correlations between the spin parameters and the binary parameter, the masses, so the from the covariance matrix. And so you're adding more parameters correlated, and so you dilute the variable information. And in fact, this was also, this is true.
That result is really only true in the absence of precession for a line.
Yes. Yes, align and anti-align. And in fact, this is true also in the case for LISA, where in fact you can see the reduction in the shear mass and the parameter mu if you take binaries and you add a spin orbit on spin-spin effect. This histogram refers to a pair of matches on output of LISA, okay? For a 1 million solar mass at 3 gigaparsec. Okay, so, but this is true without precession, and in fact, there was a paper by Vecchio that was pointing out the fact that you can decorrelate again the parameters using precession. So, now, in our case, we have waveforms for example, neutron star black hole in time domain that contain precession effects. So, the first thing we wanted to do is to evaluate the estimate the parameter using those waveforms that contain precession. And these are some preliminary results. So for a neutron star black hole, this is with LIGO, for a 10 plus 1.4 solar mass black hole, if you don't have spin, for example, the Chirp mass is estimated as 0.2%, okay? And the parameter eta 4%. When you have spin aligned, you see you degrade a lot, you go up to 4% for the Chirp mass, and actually eta you cannot even determine at all. So in this plot, we have for the same system the fractional error in the Chirp mass in percentage as a function of chi, the magnitude of the spin, and kappa, that is the angle between L and S. And you see, unless you go in the region close to align or anti-align, the value of, the estimation of the Chirp mass almost goes back to the case without spin at all, okay? So this is good news. However, we are having some problems in interpreting these results because even when you put precession, we found that we evaluated the Fisher matrix, okay?
Just a second. So this is for the Chirp mass.
This is in percentage.
In percentage, okay, sorry.
So the problem is that, so we are having some problems because when we evaluated the Fisher matrix, these are very big matrices because we have the parameter, the spin parameters, the angles, no? And that describe the direction of the binary in the sky. And so the Fisher matrix contains very small eigenvalues in certain directions. And so this sometimes poses problem of inversion, but not only. The presence of small eigenvalues means that there are some parameters that are not changing, they're almost not changing your waveform, okay? And so in correspondence of these parameters, you will have a quite big error, okay? So in principle, what one should do, one should reduce the parameter space and measure only some linear combination of the parameters. So we are now in the process of doing that. But this is quite important because this, for example, is quite important if you want to do test of GR in your system. And in fact, I want to show you something. This is still the paper, a work done with Emanuele Bert and Cliff Wheel, in which we were trying to use LISA to constrain, to test GR, because you can assume that the phase evolution omega dot, no? The evolution of the orbital frequency omega, if you are not in GR, but for example in some scalar tensor theories, you will have some new terms, no? That depends on the, for example, the Brunsdicke parameter here. You can assume that your graviton is massive, for example, and you have another term here. These are very, very small terms. So in principle, they change by very small amount your waveform. But you want to put important in this game of estimation of parameters, especially for LISA, is to understand how big are the systematics with respect to the statistical errors, okay? And in fact, this will conclude my talk because I will, in fact, comment on the possibility, or the fact that we should also evaluate spin orbit, spin effects at higher post-Newtonian order. They are needed, especially for LISA, I think. So this problem has nothing to do with detection, okay? So detection, we have a waveform for detection. I'm talking here about the estimation of parameters. And so I have here an example of two binaries, 1 million solar mass at 3 gigaparsec, 1 million 10^5 solar mass at 3 gigaparsec. I'm observing for 1 year before the ISCO. And this is the number of cycles that I have if I use a post-Newtonian waveform at different post-Newtonian orders. So Newtonian, 1PN, 1.5. I'm adding here spin orbit terms and spin-spin terms that you see are not negligible, so it's important to include them. And even in the case of smaller mass ratio, are even more important. And then here, if I don't read this part in red, if I go up to 3.5 PN order, I still have almost one cycle. That is not so small if you want to have a small bias in...
This is number of cycles in 1 year?
Yes.
The number would be higher than that.
No.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. These are equal mass. I'm sorry.
Equal mass.
I'm wrong.
Okay. And here I'm evaluating, in fact, the... So in red, I'm putting here some number of cycles that could come from spin effects, but I'm propagating in a non-correct way what is known at the lowest post-Newtonian orders, okay? But you see that they are not so small, okay? Now, actually, when I came here in February, I also discussed this with some of you, and some of you asked me, okay, but this problem can be solved if you don't integrate for 1 year, but you integrate only for the first part of the inspiral, because there the post-Newtonian works quite well, and so you should not expect that there are, that you should trust more your waveform, okay? Sorry? Okay. So so in this plot, I'm showing, in fact, how the error in the chirp mass and in eta vary as a function of the final frequency, okay? And you have, for example, the first 6 months for the two of them is here, the first 9 months, the first 11 months, 12 months minus 1 week, minus 1 day, 12 months. So this, so for me, this means that, in fact, at least you have to integrate for 11 months, I think, if you want to have something that is not so bad. And when you see how the number of cycles vary, it's true that now if you go at 3.5, this is small, okay? But it's not so small. So the number of cycles don't say everything, okay? Because what you should really do is to evaluate overlaps between the waveforms at different post-Newtonian orders and see really if they are close or not. And in fact, this is something that now we are doing with Emanuele Berti and Cliff and Yan Bei. So my last transparency.
Can you go back?
Yes.
So you would integrate for 364 days, and delta m over m is
minus 1 day.
Yeah, so 364 days. And then I integrate for one more day, and then my error goes down by a factor of 2?
Yes. Well, because it depends, I think it depends on the best sensitivity part of Lisa, in the sense that you shift the ending frequency, and maybe you are shifting a little bit from the part that is really the best sensitivity part of the Lisa noise curve.
So it's not the statistics, it's the signal is...
Yes, I think it's this.
The number of cycles is not homogeneous throughout the frequency band. You have more cycles at the end, because the higher frequency.
Yeah, that is true, but it's 1 day. It's not one day for Lisa. It's not. It's a lot of cycles. Actually, at 3 gigaparsecs, here the signal transmission is quite high. It's 1,000, 2,000. It's like for a LIGO when one has high mass binaries that end in band, that if you lose even the last cycle, it's very important.
You get a lot of information.
Yes.
That it does.
Yeah.
Okay, so when you made this plot, you chose the parameters so that the so that it'd be exactly 12 months in the.
Yes, if you want. But this is in fact called the canonical Lisa source. I think 10 to 6, 10 to 6 is the canonical.
So if one day Lisa is down.
Well, if it's the last day.
That's okay.
Yeah. If it's the last day.
Yeah. Okay, anyway.
You see the signal and you know when it is you're not supposed to be down.
So it's a part of the source requirements that you cannot be down during a certain period.
So anyway, I wanted to tell you also that because, in fact, since I care about the spin effects, I'm actually working now with Luc Blanchet and Guillaume Fay to evaluate the correction at 2.5 post-Newtonian order in the frequency. And so using post-Newtonian calculations. And this, I think, can be part, I mean, it's part of a project in which, in fact, we would like to evaluate also higher order spin terms in the waveform. So to conclude, so there were various parts in my talk. And in the first part, I showed you the performances of using of templates in the frequency domain, phenomenological and also quasi-physical, because I told you this new result in which we can relate the precession parameter to the physical parameter of the binary. And I would summarize the results as saying this is a template that has low computational cost, is simple template placement, okay? Too many physical waveforms. Well, for neutron star black hole, it's okay. I discussed a little bit about the warnings for high mass black hole, black hole. But for high mass black hole, we can still use the VCV1 templates, okay? They are, we will get high overlaps in that case. For the time domain templates, for single and also double precessing binaries, they have very high signal matching performances. So they are preferable to the frequency domain one for this reason. We propose a two-stage detection scheme that is not very high computational, is not very high computational. And the difference with this one is that the metric now is not analytical. It is in four-dimensional space, while here is three-dimensional. And it will be more complicated maybe to do the placement of the templates, but it's not impossible, okay, to do it in more than three-dimensional four. Now, I show you results from going beyond the adiabatic approximation, including the last stages of Inspiral and Plunge. There was, at some point, I point out the fact that, in fact, maybe we don't have at the moment, the various models for describing your source seems to differ quite a lot for large and almost aligned spins for very massive binaries. For the parameter estimation, I would say that because of this problem of having when you add the spin, the small eigenvalues, we have to think deeply, I think, of this problem. We will do this, in fact, in this paper with Michael and Yi and Yanbei. And for not detection, but to do a very careful estimation of parameter for space-based detector, I think that more accurate spinning waveforms are necessary, are probably needed. Okay, thank you. Sorry for the...
So while these guys are out there preparing the wine and cheese, we have time for two or three questions.
I wanted to ask you about the waveforms during the last stages. You actually showed a few. Maybe you can go back a few slides.
Yes.
Including the plunge. Does the presence of rapidly spinning and so strong spin orbit and spin interactions extend the length of time that the system spends in that plunge phase, give it more cycles?
A little bit, but not very much, because in fact, for example, okay, here, I'm sorry, it's a bit messy to understand this point, but if you consider the case, generic up means the spin are initially at 60 degrees with respect to the angular momentum, okay? So in this case, your in spiral is longer, because the ISCO is pushed more at higher frequency, okay? And in this case, that is the this line, no, the generic up is the continuous line here. This is the position of the ISCO, okay? And in our model, this is the end of the inspiral because of our equation that are no longer reliable beyond that point. And so the time between the end of the ISCO and the end of the spiral, okay, it's smaller than in the case where you have non-spinning or generic down.
Still on the order of
one cycle and half. So let's say in the anti-aligned case, the case in which the ISCO is pushed more at lower frequency, you have maybe one and half cycles with respect to one cycle in the non-spinning case. But it doesn't change by a lot.
What if you have almost completely anti-aligned?
Yes.
Do they eventually have to flip over? Eventually?
No, why? Well, actually, it should be the contrary, because the energy, because...
The energy minimized when they're...
No, it's mean. Yes, yeah, yeah. When they are, yeah, because
in
I show
EM,
you.
I know it's
no, but you don't see this behavior because it's very hard to start from this configuration and end up with this.
So I was under the impression that because it's hard, it extends the life of that plunger.
Yes. Ah. No. So you are saying that when the spin are anti-aligned, you would say that the spiral lasts more time?
Yeah.
No. In fact, I would say that because they are anti-aligned, you don't need a lot of time for the system to lose energy and plunge. And so they plunge before.
But why should we believe anything you've calculated in the vicinity of the ISCO and beyond?
In some sense, this is a model. This is not really.
No, this is not. This is a model that I hope at some point we could compare with some results from numerical relativity.
So instead of saying why should we believe it, why do you believe it?
No, I don't. I'm not saying that this is a strong prediction. Okay, this is a model that we have pushing the post-Newtonian calculation really up to the region where maybe we should not trust them very much. But it's the only thing we have, so I think it's good to take them into account. And in any case, if our templates are able to have good matches with them, we can use, I mean, the templates, these templates here. So, but I also want to say that, well, the resummation of the effect in one body here is really making a difference because. If you evolve the Hamiltonian equations expanded, you really find something very, very strange up to the end. So also that, I don't know if the EOB, the fatty one body is, you know, converging to the right limit. So, but I think there are just examples that one can use. We need also to compare these waveforms and the energy release with the paper by Baker et al. That used the Lazarus code, where they also evaluated waveforms for spinning aligned or anti-aligned binaries.
Spinning and orbiting, or was it head-on?
No, it was, well, actually, they start from the ISCO, and then they say that they evolve for very short time, and then they have this close limit approximation in which they merge, join the ring down part, and so are not waveforms that include the inspiral, and even not the last stages of inspiral before the ISCO. Okay, but they have an example with spin aligned or anti-aligned, very small spins.
So take just one more question. I'll ask my question privately afterwards. Thank you very much, Alessandra. And she will be here the rest of this week and all of next week for those who want to talk. And pursuing our collaborations with a number of people here, among other things. And